Well, good afternoon, YouTube. What place does a supercapacitor have in a solar power system? According to Wikipedia, a supercapacitor or electric double-layer capacitor or ultracapacitor is the generic term for a family of electrochemical capacitors. They often use a carbon electrode and are in between a traditional electrolytic capacitor and a battery in terms of energy density and storage. I suppose if I were going to be running a 1,000-watt car stereo off my system with some big bass speakers, that might be one reason. Well, I do have a 1,000-watt amplifier of sorts. It only puts out one frequency, right at 60 hertz. That would be this sine wave inverter. It has a small 60 hertz oscillator inside and amplifies that up to 1,000 watts at 120 volts.
Six
Maxwell 1500 farad 2.7 volt supercapacitors wired in series to make a 250 farad 16.2 volt capacitor bank. The kit from eBay seller CUSDN included the six capacitors, bus bars, and a circuit board with a voltage balancing circuit. While a supercapacitor can store a lot of energy, at least for a capacitor, it's not going to run a power inverter for very long. I charged it up and connected a 5.5 watt MR16 LED bulb to it, and it ran for about an hour before hitting 6 volts. That bulb draws constant power down to 6 volts, so that would represent 5.5 watt hours of energy down to that 6 volt reading. Now, that might run the inverter for 10 seconds at full load before the low voltage shut it down. Big deal, you might say. What good is 10 seconds of runtime good for? Well, the answer lies in starting loads with high surge currents. If you want a good explanation of surge currents and inverters, be sure to check out Neural Nar's channel over in the right sidebar. One such load I have is my old chest freezer. It uses 130 to 150 watts to run, but can use over 1800 watts to start up. My 1000 watt inverter is rated to handle 2000 watt surge loads, but I have a fairly modest battery bank with 4 to 5 small deep cycle batteries. Deep cycle batteries don't have a high surge current rating to begin with. Small batteries are similar. Combine small and deep cycle, and my bank does not give a high surge current without a high voltage drop. So the inverter used to complain about the low voltage, and sometimes it would shut off. Not the ideal thing to have the freezer turned off. Now I could go out and buy bigger batteries, and eventually I'll do that. But I wanted to try out a supercapacitor and see what it would do. I thought it might kick in a few seconds of surge current, and that might do the trick. So I did some testing with a clamp-on ammeter and the inverter ammeter and saw inrush currents in the 140 to 160 amp range. One time I saw 168 amps. With four or five parallel batteries, that's about 35 to 40 amps per battery. Considering these are 35 amp hour batteries, that is about a 1C current. I increased the wire gauge and did some other things to help the inverter with this load. Then I hooked up the capacitor bank and now have run some additional tests. In the following video clip, on the left is the trimetric meter reading the battery current, and on the right is the inverter current. You can hear the buzz when the inverter kicks on and the inverter ramps up its output. I don't have a peak and hold meter, so I grabbed some numbers off the video as the readings changed and summarized them in this chart. You can do the same thing if you step back through that part of the video and see the numbers change. Series 1 is the inverter current and series 2 is the battery current. I now get inrush currents in the 190 to 200 amp range, and the inverter no longer complains about low voltage. But the incredible finding is the battery current stays below 9 amps, assuming the charge controller has enough solar input to carry the steady state inverter load. I have the inverter connected directly off the battery bank. This way the inverter gets full current without having to run through the charge controller, which only has a 20 amp DC load capacity.
But this means that the charge controller doesn't know there's an inverter connected to the battery bank. All it sees is the battery bank voltage. When that begins to drop after the inverter starts, the controller will start increasing the charging current. It takes about 10 seconds for the charge controller to ramp up to the inverter load. It's those first seconds that the capacitor supplies the bulk of the current. And what did it look like before the capacitor? Easy, just ignore the bottom line, because the battery current equals the inverter current with no capacitors. The only difference was the peak was a little lower, about 160 amps, and the duration was a few samples longer. But with the capacitors, the inverter's happy, the batteries are happy, and everything works very smoothly now. This is just a temporary installation, so excuse the wiring mess. The plan is to have a row of Anderson connectors for each pair of batteries. There will be the trimetric battery shunt in the negative bus connecting to the system ground bus, and a 200 amp fuse in the 12 volt bus. Off the ground and 12 volt bus, I'll have a few more Anderson connectors to plug in the inverter and the capacitor with one-aught cable. The small 12 volt light bulb with the alligator clip on top of the inverter is used to charge and discharge the capacitors before connecting them to the batteries. So, that is what a supercapacitor is doing in my power system. If you want to increase the surge capacity of your inverter, this is something you might consider. If you have any questions, feel free to join the conversation in the comments section below, and be sure to rate and share this video and subscribe to this channel for future updates. Thanks for watching.